to come here since I heard the absolutely impressive work that Mr. Manish Gupta has undertaken here in Pune. He has created a new kind of energy, a new kind of capacity, and therefore a new kind of hope. And I wanted to come here and compliment you, Manishji, personally, and that's why I'm here. I'm also here because in January, I met one of your members, Vipul Kasat, who's here. And he invited me to see his plant. And I saw the kind of automation he has done there. And the kind of forward-looking vision he has. And I thought, if Vipul is like that, and if he is able to create hope, then his colleagues and his friends also must be similar. So I must go and meet them. So man mite halwas. Okay, what I'm going to do is, to begin with, I want to share stories of three kinds of entrepreneurs I have come across. I'm not going to talk about myself. But tin prakarche udyojak bhetlele ahet, tyanche mi tumhala stories mi tumhala sangen. And then we can go on from there to some of the other things that you may be interested in. So the first is Steph Wertheimer. Anytime if you feel you're not able to get me, just tell me and I'll switch to Marathi. Okay. You can just raise your hands and ask me to shift to Marathi. Mr. Steph Wertheimer, he is an Israeli entrepreneur. And he produces 12% of Israel's GDP alone. This one entrepreneur produces 12% of Israel's GDP. Just one man. He has created a facility for young entrepreneurs. It's called Tiffen Industrial Estate. And that is in northern Israel. It's called Tiffen Industrial Estate. Now, in that industrial estate, he not only provides, this is not provided by the government, not like MIDC or some of the industrial estates we have here, but this is provided by Steph Wertheimer to young entrepreneurs in Israel. And tachyamadhye sagle ahe, mhanje right from physical facilities to marketing support, management support, advice. And most important, he also provides, he has also arranged for entertainment there, music, exhibition, library, this kind of thing, because he thinks an entrepreneur needs everything. It's not just work. You must also be enriched culturally. You must also be in touch with the society around. You must be in touch with your culture. And any entrepreneur can go there, can get a free place in that industrial estate with free access to electricity and all other facilities. Free advice from Steph Wertheimer, who's producing 12% of Israel GDP, there is only one condition to get an entry, to get a place there. And that is, you should be able to provide a business plan which shows that within a short period of time, you will reach the top bracket in the entire world in your industry. Not locally, not in the local market, not in Israel, not in the Middle East, but in the entire world. This is the condition. So the entrepreneurs who go there, they have a business plan whereby they can come to the top in the entire world, in the whole world. Steph Wertheimer himself, he produces different kinds of machines and instruments. There is a floor which is only run by robots. I almost got hit by a couple of robots who were operating from here to there, just like people. So I asked him, one of the things he does is he produces some kind of very sharp cutting machines. So coming from India, I asked him, I said, do you have any business partner or an agency or distributorship in India to sell your products? So he said, yes, yes, yes. And then he took me to, he is the owner, chairman, the producer of 12% of GDP, but he was personally moving around with me from 9 in the morning till 7 in the evening. It wasn't like asking some secretary or assistant or manager to go with me. He was there, we were walking here and there in the whole complex, and nobody was standing up and saying, good morning, sir, good evening, sir, nothing. They were doing their work and we were walking and he was showing me the whole facility. So I asked him, I said, do you have anybody in India? So he said, okay, let's go to the marketing section and find out. So we went to the marketing section. There was one lady in charge of Asia. So he said, you know, this friend has come from India. So what are we doing in India? Is there anybody in India? So she opened the screen and she said, yeah, there is one small distributorship, one small company in India is handling it for us. I said, what's the name of the company? This is some small company. I said, maybe I know. They said, it's called L&T. So for him, so they say, you know L&T. I said, I know L&T. I said, it's not exactly small, but for him, it's just a small company doing his, handling his agency. But the point is that Steve Wertheimer started his life wanting to be among the top in the whole world. And the young entrepreneur whom he helps has to be very confident of taking his business plan to the top circle in the entire world, not in the country, not in the local market. So this is Steve Wertheimer and these are his young entrepreneurs. Now I'll talk about the second set of entrepreneurs. You must have heard of Gupta, that golden period when the Gupta Samrajya was in India, right? You heard? Guptanza kaal hota, Gupta Samrajya, huh? Chandragupta, Samudragupta, vagare vagare. Kunala maite kiti varsha parit, kutla varshi te Gupta Samrajya sampla? 550 AD. Okay, 550. Roman Empire had two parts, Eastern Roman Empire, Western Roman Empire. Western Roman Empire was liquidated in 400 AD. Eastern Roman Empire got liquidated in 650 AD, 100 years after the Gupta period. A business, a small enterprise was set up in 705 AD. Just 150 years after Gupta's or 50 years after Roman Empire got liquidated. It's called Nishiyama. Nishiyama Onsen Kyokan. That's the name of the enterprise or a company. And from that time till today, it is still operating. The company which was set up, the business enterprise which was set up, just about the time India had Nalanda Vidyapit, Gupta Samrajya was just over 150 years ago, Roman Empire was just over in Europe. At that time, this Nishiyama Onsen was set up in Japan as a hotel, and even today this hotel is operating. In this 1300 years of its existence, they never diversified. They have survived sticking to their core business. And it is the same family which set up the business in 705, that same family is running the business today. So today is the 47th generation of the same family which is running the business. So now you might ask, what happens along the line? I mean, 47 generation is a long time, 1300 years. Ki kadhi mulga jhala nahi tar kay? Asa jhala bareza. Tar jya jya vela mulgi jhali, tya vela tyanni tya mulini lagna gela ani ghar jave anla ghari. Ani ma tya mulala tya ghar jave la tyanni honorary mulga mhanun tharavla. So the generation continued. So the girl never left the house. She brought the bridegroom home and the family continued. So now there is 47 generation. This is the oldest enterprise that exists in the world. And it's in a hotel business. From 705 to now, I mean, you imagine Gupta period. This is Nalanda Vidyapit was there at that time in India. Chalukya, you heard of Chalukya, Chalukya Rajgharana in the southern India. Chalukya had just started their life. This is 1000 years before Shivaji Maharaj came, when this company was set up, 1000 years before he came, or 900 years before he came. From that time, this company was set up and it's still running. We don't even have any company which was set up during Shivaji Maharaj's time that is still there. There are many hotels and restaurants which were set up in last 1000 years, last 500 years, which are still in business, run by the same families or the same company. I was in Venice last year. I go to Venice once in a while. And I went to have a lunch in a place called Cafe Florian. Now this Cafe Florian is also run by the same family since it was set up. It was set up in San Marco Church in Venice, that's the location. On the day in Pune, Thorla Bajirao was anointed as a Peshwa. ज्या दिवशी थोरल्या बाजीरावांना पेशवा अपॉइंट केलं 1720 मध्ये त्या दिवशी कॅफे फ्लोरियन तिथे सुरू झालं आणि अजूनही ते कॅफे फ्लोरियन अव्यवहारपणे चालू आहे विदाउट स्टॉपिंग फॉर लास्ट 300 इयर्स 1720 इट वॉज सेटअप अँड इट इज स्टील रनिंग आय वन स्टेड इन अ हॉटेल विच वॉज सेटअप नॉट सो लाँग अगो 250 इयर्स अगो अँड द कबर्ड्स इन द हॉटेल आर स्टील फ्रॉम द टाइम इट वॉज सेटअप And I had a big problem opening the doors because they were so huge, so massive. And I had to hold the locks, the kadi asteti, meshe don hatani khechun kadaycho. It was not possible to open the lock also, latch also. Forget, lock was not required, but even latch. This is in Switzerland. It's called Gasthofhausen at Eglisau. So, there are many hotels and restaurants particularly, but even some other companies which have been set up 1300 years ago is the oldest, but 500 years ago, 600 years ago, and they have been running same family or same company, no diversification, sticking to the core business and running for last 300 years, 400 years, 500 years, with exception 1300 years. Now this Nishiyama is in the eastern part of Japan. 20 years after Ishiyama was set up, another hotel was set up in the western part of Japan, and that is also running non-stop from that time. But because it was set up 20 years later, it is not as famous as Nishiyama. They lost it by 20 years. So the Guinness Book of Records has Nishiyama, but not the other hotel, which is in western part. But can you imagine in 705, what must be the situation? There must be deep forest everywhere. I mean, it's difficult to imagine what must be 1300 years ago, and it's still there. So there are enterprises which have been there for 300 years, 400 years, 500 years, and some like this for 1300 years, some 1000 years. Most of them are hotels and restaurants, but there are also some in other businesses. There is a company called Fabriano in Italy. This was formally set up around 1750 or something, but informally it has been operating from 1264. So from 1264 to now, so almost 700 years is come. And this company is making papers. This is not in the restaurant or cafe or hotel. It's making paper. So Michelangelo, you all heard of Michelangelo? So Michelangelo used to buy paper from Fabriano to paint, and today the European Central Bank buys paper from Fabriano to print the euro notes. And even I found out recently Reserve Bank of India also buys paper from Fabriano to print some of the rupee notes. Not all of our rupee notes are on the Fabriano paper, but some notes are on the Fabriano paper. So the rupee note probably which is in your pocket now, and it's again single product, core business, running since 1264. It's coming from the same company that provided paper to Michelangelo in 14th, 15th century. So there are these businesses which have been running enterprises for so many hundreds of years. I'll come to the third set of entrepreneurs that I have come across. There's the Chinese guy. I used to keep meeting him. Recently, I not met him. In a certain forum. So first time I met him, I said, what do you do after some discussion on world and China and this and that, etc., technology? Somewhere you come down and ask, what do you do? So he said, I'm in garment business. So I said, what garment? So he said, I export bed sheets to New York. So he used to export bed sheets. Next year I asked him, what do you do? He said, you know, my business grew, these bed sheets. So I diversified into nanotechnology. So he set up He invested his profits to produce paints, house paints or wall paints by using nanotechnology. And he came up with a paint which was more durable than the normal paints in the market, more eco-friendly, and what must be the cost? What percentage must be the cost of a normal paint, say Asian paints or any of the other paints that are operating? 5%. So if X liters of paint is available for $100, he's producing it for $5. The next year I met him, he's become multi-millionaire, because if you are selling a product for 5%, absolutely nobody can compete with you. And this is not by cheap labor, but by introducing a new technology. The Chinese are way ahead in high technology. I was once in a meeting with the chairman of Lenovo company. You must have heard of Lenovo computer company. So he was telling me, and this was some years ago, this is not last year or year before, but maybe 7-8 years ago. He was telling me that he employs 1,000 people only for research. And the strict instructions are they should not think about production, and they should not think about marketing, and they should not think about management. So 1,000 people doing full-time research who are instructed not to think about production, marketing and management. Their full-time job is research. And this was then, now maybe it is 5,000 people by now. Similarly, Steph Wertheimer, I mentioned earlier, the Israeli guy, he has 1,000 people only doing research. I visited his research factory, you can say, only doing research. And the strict rule is that those who are in research should not worry about production and marketing, and definitely not management. They should only focus on the research. Few months ago, I was in Kiev in Ukraine, and there were 300 Chinese businessmen had come, and they were all SMEs, and they were buying companies in Kiev, each company for $1 million or $1.5 million, which in the rupees is like 10 crores to 12 crore rupees. They were all buying companies in Kiev at this price, $1 million, $2 million, $1.5 million, because Kiev in Ukraine, they have tremendous capacity in high technology, in artificial intelligence and mathematics. So they were buying all the companies in mathematics and artificial intelligence and blockchain. And in front of me, 300 of the Chinese, I mean not all 300, but many of them bought so many companies there. I couldn't see a single Indian trying to do this. I mean 10, 12 crore, 15 crore is not a big amount. But vision is where the difference is. And Chinese, they are quite high on technology. They are doing original research in everything. You name a field and the Chinese are doing original research. Chinese, I mean, they have a bad environmental record, they have a dictatorship, all those factors are there. I'm not saying everything about China is good. It's a very aggressive country, those factors are there, those are political and other factors. But when it comes to entrepreneurship, the Chinese entrepreneurship is totally research focused. And every day there are millions kinds of research efforts going on. And they're futuristically oriented. In Strategic Foresight Group, we look into future. And so once some Chinese approached me, and they said that, you know, can you help us to do scenario building for future, for China? And I said, yes, I said, we can do a scenario building for 2030 to 2050 period. 2030 to 2050. They said, no, we already know what's going to happen till 2050. We want your help to think beyond 2050. This is how the Chinese are thinking. They have petaflop computers. India has only one petaflop computer. It's in Pune. So petaflop is the fastest computer. But the China's petaflop computer is like 100 times faster than the Indian petaflop computer. And we have only one. They have hundreds of computers. And each one of them is much faster. They are deep into nanotechnology. They are into blockchain. They are into artificial intelligence. And they are going left, right and center to European countries and buying companies like this. They are into space supplies. Space means outer space, industry supplies. They're everywhere. Sometime back, the Chinese reduced the number of or the manpower of their army, the People's Liberation Army. But what did they do? I mean, they reduced the number of soldiers, but they appointed, instead of that, engineers and scientists in the army. So the Chinese army is now getting more and more populated by engineers and scientists. And the soldiers are getting reduced. So the Chinese think that the next war, whenever they are involved in it, or next world war, that will be fought by the scientists and engineers, not by the soldiers. Soldiers is the third world countries who fight with soldiers. So the Chinese entrepreneurs, they are all totally focused on new technologies. And so a man who is selling garments or bed sheets, the moment he makes profits, he invests into nanotechnology. And the 300 Chinese, one of them was in real estate. And the real estate guy is investing in blockchain. And that is how they are thinking. So these are the three different kinds of entrepreneurs that I have come across. And since you are a club of entrepreneurs, I thought I should share this experience with you. So there are people who think not locally, not nationally, not globally, but not just in terms of talking, but they have a business plan to make them top in the world, if not top in the top bracket. Business plan, concrete business plan. Because here in India, everybody talks about global. The moment you start talking about anything, everybody starts global. You come from, travel from Mumbai to Pune, you see so many institutions, we have got name global in it. You just do anything and you just add one word global. To say global is one thing, but to have a, what is that, we also talk about being global power, this power, that power, but to have a business plan which concretely makes you within and within 5 years, if you are not there in the top bracket of the world, you are thrown out of Tiffin Industrial Estate. So there is a price to be paid for that. And in 5 years, if you reach there, you are still thrown out, because now you are become a leader and you should be able to create a Tiffin Industrial Estate of your own. So there are people who think global, make their business plans which are globally viable. And this is for startups. This is not for companies which have been around. The companies who are given opportunity are the ones who have got 0 years of experience and who must have a global blueprint to reach the top bracket in the world with 0 years of work experience or 6 months of work experience at the most. It is for them. Second, you have these entrepreneurs who set up enterprises which go for 300 years, 500 years on an average, but also 1,000, 1,300 years. And third, you have these entrepreneurs who are looking at the future and focusing on technology. You have to ask yourself today, how many of you have got business plans to reach top place in the world in the next 5 years? How many of you have a business plan which will make your company survive for less next 1,000 years or at least next 100 years? And how many of you have recruited at least 20 people whose full-time job is research and whom you are not pressurizing to think of marketing or production? I'm not going to ask you to raise hands. I'm asking you to look into your heart and look into yourself and see where you are. This is where the world is going. And it's possible for everybody. I'll conclude telling my own story very briefly, not the whole story, but one element of the story. I set up Strategic Foresight Group in 2002. We are three founders. And we decided, 2001, we had a meeting in the residence of one of the three. And we conceived the idea of Strategic Foresight Group. And we said we will launch it in January 2002. And we said that we are going to go into strategic foresight, it's a new field. And we have a simple objective that within 5 years in our field, we should reach the top bracket in the entire world. Not in India, not in Asia, but in the entire world. And top bracket as recognized by others, not by us, because we can always declare ourselves to be among the top in the world, but top bracket as recognized. Well, we reach that target in 2 years. And we were invited to Davos, to World Economic Forum, as one of the top 20 players in the world. Today there are some aspects where we are the top in the world. And the difference between us and the number two is vast. Once we got a contract from the Swiss government, and the Swiss government wanted to offer a contract. And so there was a lot of lot of commotion in Switzerland. And they said, how can you offer a contract on a policy matters, policy research to a think tank in an enterprise in India? When what are the, Switzerland is an advanced country, Switzerland is not Kenya or Laos or something. There are a lot of people, a lot of companies, a lot of enterprises, think tanks in Switzerland. Why not there? Why are you going to India? So the Swiss government said, look, you know, we are in a problem. There will be questions in the parliament as to why we are offering a contract. So we have to go for a tender. I said, I'm not participating in tender. I have a fixed rule that I don't participate in tender, I don't contest elections, and I don't bid for anything. Everything has to be offered. Absolutely. I don't participate in tender. So he said, now how do we solve the problem? Because we have pressure within the country and the pressure is going to be reflected in the parliament. I said, why don't you do one thing? You call for a tender for the Swiss suppliers, for the Swiss companies, and you say these are the strengths of Strategic Foresight Group, and whoever matches, you give the contract to them. And if it doesn't, you don't find anybody to match, then you give it to us without tender on offer at request basis. So they gave a tender. They couldn't find anybody who was matching us in entire Switzerland. They expanded it to Europe. They couldn't find anybody who could match us in entire Europe. They repeated the tender. They couldn't still find anybody else who could match us. So finally they came and they asked us to, they requested us to take the contract. So my point is, and all my staff, they are all 27, 20 year old young women. And who are delivering, who are changing policies. We go to barista or cafe coffee day in the afternoon. Our offices are very small. And we say, okay, what's happening in the world? Okay, okay, Egypt, Ethiopia having problem. Let's solve the problem. So we go back and we go back from barista, we write to Egypt, Ethiopia, oh, you're having this problem, we have a solution, fine. Within 10 days, we are on the plane. Yeah. And this is how it works. We just go to barista, then barista is closed, but nowadays cafe coffee day, and what is that, cafe latte is there in Mumbai. We just go, we sit there in the afternoon, we say, where is the problem? Oh, okay, UN Security Council is not taking up these issues. Okay, okay, let's sort it out. So we can come back, we say, okay, how do we go about it? We make a strategy, we shoot out 2-3 emails, that's it. Within 10-15 days, we are on the plane. This is how it works. So you can be in the top bracket in the world. And we did it in 2 years. So anybody can do it. Nothing extraordinary. All three of us are just normal people. And our staff is normal people. Nothing extraordinary. It's just a thought. What matters is thought. But your thought, your belief has to be supported by action. A thought is a thought. A thought is a belief if it is supported by action. If a thought is not supported by action, it's not a belief, it's only daydreaming. So with that note, since it's not a day, it's evening, I wish you nice dreams tonight, and I'm happy here to interact more with you. Thank you, Manishji, for inviting me.